I just wrote you good morning to it, and she wrote good morning to me at the same time.
Peter, do you want to start?
I mean,
his sound is maybe off.
Yeah.
Sound was off indeed. it's already recorded. Okay, hi everyone. Right, so I want to continue my discussion of liquid and real vector spaces. By the way, I mean, in some previous lectures, there was a lot of stuff where there's no written reference for this, but for what I'm talking about, both yesterday and today, there's actually a reference. And this is about lectures 3 until 9, basically, of this analytic.pdf. And basically 3 to 6 were yesterday, and roughly 6 to 9 or something like this is today. So let me recall a little bit about where we are. So the goal, I recall, was to define a series of so-called liquid R vector spaces, somehow extending, in some sense, this classical notion of complete locally convex vector spaces. But having the same excellent categorical properties. Something's wrong with my sound, I believe.
Can somebody say something so that I know that I have my sound?
Yes. I mean,
yes. Okay. So I think
we can hear you perfectly. It's all good.
Can you say something again?
Yes.
Yeah, now it's over my microphone. Okay. Great.
Okay.
Okay. Having the same categorical properties as, say, solid QP vector spaces. So in particular, get a nice derived category. And if you read classical functional analysis literature, you will realize that actually there's basically no literature really getting a nice derived category in this functional analysis of the real numbers. I mean, there's one paper by Fabian Postmans that goes in this direction. Has almost no citations. And then there is this idea of just using the nth category or somehow from built from Banach spaces. You just declare Banach space to be a compact projective object, and then you just formally extend from there. But then somehow not clear what the objects in some sense really are. So we really want our objects to be just certain condensed R vector spaces. Okay. Right. So for this, we defined some of these complete guys on profinite sets. And so these were actually dependent on this additional parameter P. And then we had these P measures on S, where S was on profinite set. This was a union of all cutoffs, some of all constants of the limit over the free R vector spaces on some on this finite sets as I, and generally takes a part where the LP norm is less or equal to C. And you can take M less than P of this. The union of all P prime less than P. It's P prime measures. So let me recall that if P is equal to 1, you would get this picture of such then I know P is, I don't know, half, you would get something more like so, depending inwards. P is, I don't know, a quarter. It's even closer. So you're adding fewer and fewer steps to this. I should also note that how do measures actually look like? You can actually check that any mu and such a guy when p is less than one make this remark, is a countable. I mean, in the underlying thing, like this way. Yeah, I'm not thinking about temperature. I'm not a physicist. Is accountable sum of Dirac measures. And so in this sense, this is actually not so much completed. So it's something like the Hahn measure or something like a usual, yeah, it's like a Hahn measure on a group or something like this will never be a P measure when P is less than one. And we can actually prove that whatever measures you can plausibly take to build such a theory, it must always be things that are only allow countable sums of Dirac measures on the underlying vector space. So yeah, let me leave this as an exercise. You can find the proof in the notes. Okay, so, and then the theorem was that. Together with this association, taking this to the P measures. Well, it defines what we call an analytic ring, and we didn't really define this in the lectures. But it's, this just means it satisfies this axiom star from Dustin's talk. So Dustin gave some general axiom on some kind of localization on a compact on a being category with compact projective generators that would ensure that you even the localized category somehow has very good properties. Right, so in particular, let me just say it like this. And so, a key part of this is that if B is a P Banach space, over R, then the R home from the space of less than P measures to V. Same thing as it. And so we need to compute such forms here. And let me maybe also make a remark that, and this will somehow, I will explain why in a later. So, this does not define. For any value of P. And in fact, what happens, there are factorial in S in general non-split extensions. Of the space of P measures by itself. There, you can construct them explicitly using entropy, so it can be constructed using entropy. Very much like what I briefly explained in the last talk. So basically, you for any finite set S, it just takes a split extension, but you endow it with a slightly funny norm that is somewhat twisted by the entropy function. And then you somehow run this machine of somehow taking a limit with bounded norm and then taking the union afterwards. And because the norms here have this funny twist by the entropy function, you see that this is actually a non-split extension if you go to infinite sets. And this works no matter what P is. So for any value of P, you can find these non-split extensions. In fact, something we realized then is that you can make this here into some an R join epsilon mod epsilon squared module. So this is really a deformation of R with this association S maps to and P of S to this ring. So you can somehow, in a non-trivial way, deform the theory of P measures to this ring R join epsilon mod epsilon squared. And then we actually wondered whether you need to stop here when for epsilon squared. And it turns out you don't have to stop. You can actually deform to all infinitesimal neighborhoods. So you can actually deform. In fact, you can deform. All the way to our power series in epsilon. This is actually a little bit tricky to make explicit. It actually has some passing resemblance to Fontaine's construction of Bidouran plus. So if instead you
we can't hear you. You're muted.
You muted me again. Sorry. You should let me know quickly. Otherwise, I will continue speaking. And you don't hear me. So this construction, if you carry it out, actually has some passing resemblance to Fontaine's construction of this important period ring Bidouran plus and Pierre de Cotes, which is abstractly isomorphic also to such a power series ring over CP. But not canonically so. Projecting onto CP. So I like to think of this funny construction here as some kind of real analog of Fontaine's construction of this ring Bidouran plus. And we will actually see it coming up in a different way. So you can construct it explicitly, just somehow starting from the real numbers. And I will later give a different description of what this is. That will somehow come up automatically when we prove the main theorem. Prove this theorem here. Okay. Do this extension. Yes, I will discuss that they don't exist over the convergence thing. Rather, the convergence thing itself gives rise to them. Well, let me discuss it when I'm there. So, as I already indicated last time, the problem in proving the theorem is that we need to resolve R vector spaces by the free R vector spaces on profinite sets. If you want to compute anything, any X groups in condensed R vector spaces, then well, the free guys are still the guys on profinite sets, and a priori, you only know the X from maybe the free guys on extremely disconnected sets. And then, if you want to compute something, you need to pick such a resolution, but you want to compute, so it must be sufficiently explicit. And so you someone need to be able to do this in a sufficiently explicit way. And yeah, I don't know. I mean, there is somehow usually no canonical way of picking subjections onto the real numbers from profinite sets, just like that. So this is why we actually somehow change the setup. We have to change the base ring. And so we actually, so the idea is somehow to take these convergent Laurent series over the integers, subjecting onto the reals instead, as I already indicated a little bit last time. And so I will actually use a specific version of a convergence condition here. So let me actually say precisely which ring I want to take. Let's zero. So let me pick some radius of convergence. yes, so distance answer. So and let this be the condensed ring. And given basically by so let me explain the condensed structure in just a second. So it's a set of all those power series an times t to the n. Such that the sum of an times r to the n is bounded. And we rewrite this as a union of all c of the same of set of all such f's such that the sum of a n times r to the n is less or equal to c. And these things here, they're actually profinite. Namely, each a n can take only finitely many possibilities. Because if one, forgot something important. I need, of course, need to take the absolute values here. I mean, if one an is already itself too large, then this inequality would already be violated. So all the ans are a certain finite set if they're integers and bounded, and so each an can take only finitely many values, and they're equal to zero if n is sufficiently negative. And so it somehow embeds into a product, this whole thing embeds into a product of finite sets. And so is then a closed subset of a product of finite sets. That's a profinite set. So I endow each of those with some of this profinite topology, and then I take a union. So it's a countable union of profinite things. And of course, I can replace all real numbers here by just some cofinal countable connection. These functions, so f and z Laurent series t converges for zero is less than the absolute values, less than t is less than r. T is some complex numbers, some complex number. Can I allow equality here? Maybe less or equal, I don't know. But I mean, things get, I guess I can allow equality here. Yes. As a subspace of product of z's. It's a subspace of all the other properties. I mean, there's actually a different topology. So you might also consider this thing here as a norm and then endow it with a norm topology. So, and then this would be more like a Banach space, but I rather use a Smith space version, not the Banach space version. Right, so these are some functions that, well, converge everywhere in the non-Archimedean world, of course. And in the Archimedean world, they still converge up to radius r. Okay, and so this actually comes with a very natural choice of spaces of measures. And we just actually do the obvious thing. So for finite set S. Let CR in essence C be those sums A n, so n and S and S times T to the n times S such that the sum is S equal to C. So basically, you're just taking the norm of each, the norm in this sense of each basis element, coordinate, and then summing them over all elements of S. And then, so in this way, you write this whole free module as a union of these things with bounded norm, and let the measures on S in this C long series TR series be defined in this usual way now. So we're getting the hang. So the limit over this of the free guy is equal to C. And so we bound again. So we bound at each finite stage, then we first take a limit and then only afterwards we scale out everything again. Okay, so okay, and so similarly, we can define some of the things that are overconvergent. So that's the union of all R prime greater than R. Let's see, wrong, so it's T R prime, and we have this overconvergent one. So in this case, if you think about it, the transition maps are actually in this way that you can take a union in this form. Okay, and so I first want to discuss the relation between between the series that we defined over these convergent Laurent series now and these spaces of P measures that we had previously. So note that for each zero less than, do I use T anywhere? I use T here. We get a map. We call it theta T, which goes from the Laurent series T R to the reals and sends T to this element T. And then we have the following proposition. So the kernel of this map is generated by some element. We call it FT. This principle. So you're writing here the real numbers as a quotient by one element of this Laurent series thing. So all my R's are less than one. Yeah? But it's a union of all such R. So some R prime anyway gets close to R and R is less than one. So only those matter. So this principle, and then they exist, the canonical isomorphism. So what can I do now? So I can take the space of measures that I have. Like when I did this for this Laurent series thing, okay, there was a choice of convergence radius anyways, but okay, this I had to choose because I want to have some definite ring. So I need to put some definite convergence condition here. But then in the space of measures, I basically didn't make any further choices. I mean, over the real numbers, we had this choice of this P. Here we don't have any choice. We just still use the same norm that we had on the base ring, and then we're just summing it up over all basis vectors. So this is like a completely canonical thing. But now, of course, okay, there's this choice of where we evaluate this guy. And so I can mod this out by this f of t. And so this is now a module. I will write the right hand side in a second. So, but that's more often somewhere as condensed Z Laurent series T R modulo F of T, which is the same thing by part one as R modulo. Yes, actually the isomorphism is really as condensed strings here. Think about it. And so the right hand side is exactly the space of P measures on S. Well, scale coefficients. I didn't write this before. Where, what is P? Where P is chosen such that T to the P is equal to R. Okay, so what's happening here? So we have this ring of Laurent series, and particular, like in the spectrum of it, we somehow have this whole line of real points. This line here, this is somehow 0 less than t less than equal to r. And as we move along this line, we somehow get lots of different copies of the real numbers. And these copies are actually exactly interpolating between all these different LP series that we defined. Okay, so there's really geometric variation now, realizing all these different series. And three, somehow. Now, what I can also do is I can take this series that's defined over the integers and mod out not by Ft, but by Ft squared. And then this sits in a similar sequence with, so you can multiply by Ft. I have this mod Ft. And this is the construction. This is the extension. Zero maps to MP. Constructed via entropy. And in fact, this real Bidouran plus is the completion at Ft of the Z Laurent series TR. So you can also now, instead of just modding out by Ft squared, you can mod out by any power of Ft, and then you get a whole infinitesimal deformation. And you can show that this whole infinitesimation, this what I call the real version of Bidouran plus, is really this completion. So what happens? So somehow you can you have this parameter P here, and you can vary this, and you get this whole line of series. But in some sense, as you let P vary just infinitesimally, if you let it vary only infinitesimally, then you get these funny self-extensions here. So somehow, in some sense, parameter P is some kind of holomorphic variable on this disk, more or less. And yeah, actual deformations give rise to this different series, and infinitesimal deformations give rise to such extensions. There was the question how it all depends on this radius r. And well, obviously this ring depends on it, but actually in some sense it doesn't, you don't see much any dependence on r in particular. And this picture, like, it's just some rescaling issue. What is the p here in terms of r? Okay. So yeah, so some of this purely formal variation of different p measures that we somehow ran into just because we had to introduce this measure of non-convexity. This is somehow part of the variation that you somehow see in the spectrum of this Laurent series ring here. So this, by the way, is a, well, not quite this, but it's over convergent version, is a principal ideal domain. I will come to this in a second. Okay, so what's the time? It's actually not hard to prove these things, but maybe a little bit confusing, and maybe I don't want to do it right here. But somehow what you have to see, it's maybe a priori surprising that these funny p measures come up here, because there was nothing about p measures when we did stuff here. Yeah, there were no p measures around here. I was just taking absolute values here. It's just that, some of the t has absolute value r in some sense here, but then it goes to this t here, and then this difference is responsible for this. Is there a simple explicit description of the FT? Yes. You can be reasonably explicit about them. So actually, when I ran into this point of the course, when I gave this course, I had the suspicion that this ought to be true, that this ideal is principal. I wasn't actually able to prove it unless, so I could prove it if r is less than a half or something like this. But if r gets closer and closer to one, it actually gets harder and harder to prove this statement. And then actually Ben Hoyer, who's here in Bonn, he came up with a proof, a very clever proof for this. But then we actually realized that David Harbata in the 80s already gave a proof. And it's a quite short proof, but it's a bit clever. Is there a real TP? I'm not sure. I mean, I'm not actually sure about the significance of any of these speed around pluses here, because they don't actually fall into this framework of analytic rings. So yeah, I'm still a little bit lost about the meaning of all of this, but I think there is some meaning to this. I'm not sure what it is. Another thing I should say is that this quest for finding a real Biedermann plus and has also been very much taken on by Alan Kohn and Katharina Constani and so on. And they also realized that it's surely related to something about entropy. So they have some papers where they're also talking about some real version of Biedermann plus and something with entropy and so on. So maybe. And I think the relation here is a bit different than what they are doing, but yeah. Okay. Okay, so and so corollary is that the space of measures, if you do this over convergent version, it's modeled by FT. You get the space of less than P measures. Yes. And so this means that it's enough to prove the following theorem instead, that you can define a liquid theory over these over convergence. You can find the reference to this Harbata paper in my analytic geometry course. Okay, so this and sending S to the space of measures, this defines. So there is a series of liquid. Liquid modules over this ring of overconvergent neuron series. Okay, and so here we are in better shape. As this ring. Somehow locally profinite in some sense. Or better to say, countable union of profinite. I mean, you have to get used to the fact that profinite things are better than compact torsos, general compact torsos spaces. They are. Okay. So, right. Maybe what I want to describe now is actually the geometry of this ring or of its spectrum. And so, so this is actually something you need to understand if you want to prove the theorem. We've made our lives easier in this way that we've now some in this countable union of profinite situation. We've made our lives much more difficult because we have replaced the real numbers by a ring that seems much more complicated. In particular, I think I will have a very hard time convincing hardcore functional analysts that they should care about this ring here. So let me try to describe the geometry here a bit. And so there we have the following theorem of Harberton from the 80s, I think. That 84. Okay, so the ring of this overconvergent Laurent series is a principal ideal domain. And the maximal ideals are the following. So for any complex number of absolute value at most r, you have the kernel of the map to the complex numbers. G2x. And okay, this doesn't really depend on x, it only depends on x up to complex conjugation. This depends only on x. And conversely, it determines x up to complex conjugation. So, for any pair of complex conjugate complex numbers of absolute value at most r, you get one of these points. You can do the similar thing. You can do the similar thing actually in replacing the complex numbers by the periodic numbers. So for any non-zero periodic number, and now you just need that it's topologically nilpotent, and you have the kernel of the Laurent series G greater than R of G bar next to X. And again, this depends only on the Galois out. And determines this Galois out. And then finally, we have for any prime number p. So by the way, here, I'm not sure how to resolve this thing that there's prime numbers are called p and lp, like this is p and lp. You have the ideal generated by p, which is also, if you want, a kernel of this map. From C long series to greater than to FP long series. So basically, all possible local fields arise as quotients of this one guy here. So it's enough. It's some funny. I mean, it's a curve, right? So the spectrum, it's a spectrum of a principal ideal domain. So this is some kind of curve. And it's a really funny curve because it contains all these punctured open unit disks over all these non-Archimedean fields glued together. And let me try to draw a picture. I'm not really sure how to draw a good picture of this. So somehow you have a part of this curve that's over C. This is a punctured curve. And then it says radius R. Where's all this? And then there it has a part of a Q2, which is also punctured open unit disk of radius 1. And then actually at the boundary of this open unit disk, you have a point that corresponds to FP Laurent series T. And recall that somehow being a Laurent series ring, you very much think of this as a punctured open unit disk, so very much as a circle. And it's really somehow the boundary circle of this punctured open unit disk here. And then you also have a Q3 and so on. And over all other non-Archimedean fields, you have a punctured open unit disk. And again, at the boundary of this, you have a point whose residue field is F3 Laurent series T. Somehow all of these things are actually glued along in some sense at the origin. So if you this is some of the generic point, in some sense corresponds to Q Laurent series T. So how does the geometry on this curve look like? When you're in one of these disks, then this punctured open unit disk has two ends. It has an end towards the boundary, and if you go towards the boundary, you end up in characteristic P, which is field of FP Laurent series T. Or you can go towards the center of the disk. And you can never reach the center of the disk. Instead, what happens when you go to the center of the disk is that you reach this point for Q Laurent series T. And when you're there, which is some of the generic one, and when you're there, you can go to all other possible non-Archimedean disks. I don't know. They're all glued together like that. That's some of the origins. Yeah. So somehow, in particular, like in principle, we are interested in this Archimedean disk because there's our real numbers live that we actually care about right now. And so there, well, we can't really go to the boundary of this disk because we made this convergence condition. So we can only go up to radius R anyways, but we can go to the origin of the disk. So which corresponds to letting the P measures, the P go to zero. And then when we enter this disk, then suddenly we're entering the arithmetic world of this picture where we have the residue field is Q Laurent series T, and from there we can go to all other non-Archimedean disks. So it's quite a funny space, I think. Combining Archimedean and non-Archimedean geometry in this really funny way. Right. Okay. All right. So this is what I wanted to say next. Right. So a corollary of this is that we can also specialize. Liquid QL vector spaces. So now I resolve this issue of about P versus L by just renaming my prime as L. liquid QL vector spaces. So somehow by taking you can map this to QL by say sending T to L. So this would then be Z Laurent series T R greater than R modulo T minus L. For example. So because we define it over this arithmetic ring, and we have to in some sense, we can then suddenly we realize that we can also specialize instead to the analytic numbers of series. The question was whether, yeah, it's not a coincidence that it's also like the Birkovich space. Yeah. It is the same thing. And so one can also describe this explicitly, so can also describe these liquid QL series in terms of P measures. So, and for this, because we are in the non-Archimedean world, we actually can go, we can let our P go all the way to infinity. So this here. This is not necessary. Yes, QL is non-Archimedean. Net for S finite. We define the QL vector space on S where the so there's still an issue about L versus L, but now it's an LP, so that, I don't know. That's equal to C as a set of all such XS, S, and S. Well, the XS is of course in QL, such that the sum over all the absolute values of the XS's, the P's power is less or equal to C. And so this is just the usual L-adic absolute value normalized in whatever way you like. So say the absolute value of L is 1 over L. And then you can do the same thing of just raising to the p's power and then asking that that's equal to C. And then you can define this this p measures on S with QL coefficients when S is a profinite. As again being this union of all C greater than zero of the measures, of the limit over I of QP adjoin S where the LP norm is less or equal to C. And then as usual, M less than P is a union of all P prime less than P, M less than P prime. And then the corollary is more precisely that QL with this M less than P series is an analytic ring for all zero less than P less than infinity. And you can somehow, the reason that you can allow all zero less than P less than infinity is also the same that, so here you have the whole punctured open unit disk. In some sense, you don't hit the boundary, so you can go all the way towards the boundary and you get, whereas here you somehow are stuck somewhere, which is like the cutoff at P equal to one in some sense. and so somehow what happens now in this non-Archimedean theory, right, is that we all have this whole half open interval, zero less than P less than infinity, where we have all different liquid series. But in this case, we can actually also go to P equal to infinity. And what happens if you do P equal to infinity? Let me draw it in red here. So if we would say L infinity is less or equal to C, then we would say that the supremum norm here is less or equal to C. But if we do that, so if we do here L infinity less or equal to C, then this would exactly be as this usual QP adjoin S solidified. Because what does it mean to bounce the L infinity norm here? It just means that, well, if I would put C equal to 1, then this would just be ZP join S, or Z, sorry, ZL join S. You would just have the usual unit ball, and then you take the limit of the unit balls, and then you, well, you get ZP join S solidified. And then if you take this union again, you just invert P. So putting P, replacing the LP norms here by the L infinity norm, by the supremum norm, is exactly recovering the solid theory. So the boundary here, you get the solid theory. What happens in some sense, you can also put P equal to 0 here. This would be the L0 norm. And the L0 norm should mean that there are only a finite number of things are non-zero. And you can actually show that this would lead to the theory, so the completely uncompleted theory, so all condensed. So if you somewhat do the similar formula here and using the L0 norm, so if I put L0 less or equal to C here instead, then I just get Q, sorry, this is an L, QL join S without any completions whatsoever. And so you might think of this limit case L equal to zero as somehow being gauges or something like this. And so in this way, there is like this whole, yeah, whole parameter of families of different kinds of completeness over this field QL, ranging from all condensed QL vector spaces, gauges, not completed at all. And then as you increase P, they become more and more completed. Become more and more viscous somehow. And then when you go to P infinity, that's a solid theory. Okay. This is fun. What's the time? So there are 8 minutes left right now. Ah, there's a question. I'm not sure what you mean here. So yeah, I mentioned this this real Biedermann plus, but I'm actually not sure how it's related to Hodge theory or how it's related to Piard Hodge theory. So there's still a lot of mystery around, but feels like there is something there. I don't know. Okay, I'm just wondering whether there's anything. There's one thing I can still say before we make the break. So here's another proposition that will actually be relevant for the proof. The forgetful functor. So you can take, say, liquid R vector spaces and forget all the way down to condensed Z modules. And so somehow you forget in particular the R linear structure of your real vector spaces. Yes, because you can compute the free guys, right? The free guys are some of the completions in your theory, and they will tell you what the P is. So this forgetful functor is fully faithful, and so in particular, like the structure as an R vector space is completely determined by the underlying condensed Debian group, and so similarly, the theory of, I don't know, liquid things over Z Laurent series T greater than R. This is also just determined if you only know how T acts, and in fact, you only need to know how, more precisely, T inverse condensed modules with Z adjoint T inverse are fully faithful. Equivalently, somehow, you can somehow also consider Z, the condensed string Z, but with the association where somehow you'd want the free guys to be the spaces of real measures on R. And similarly, you can take just the uncompleted guy with the theory of measures on this guy. they define analytic rings. So somehow there's not a real axiom in an analytic ring a priori that states that the measures on a point must be your base ring. You can also redeclare the measures on a point to be something else, as long as somehow this forgetful functor in the end still turns out to be fully faithful. So this is, you still want to isolate this category in here, which is somehow even a stronger statement than what we originally wanted, just isolate some condensed R vector spaces. But it's actually, for the proof, it's more convenient to work over a smaller ring, because when you try to construct resolutions, you somehow need to construct resolutions as modules over things. But when your ring is too big, some of the free modules tend to be a bit too complicated. So it's actually better to have a small ring as your base ring when you prove stuff. And of course, it also gives you a stronger statement in the end. So. Yeah, so we will actually end up somehow trying to prove that this thing here is an analytic ring when we go on just in a minute. And particularly resolve this guy by free condensed modules over just this polynomial algebra. All right, so now basically time is up. So let me stop here for a moment.